So what's happening, everybody? This episode of the podcast is sponsored by Delta Leaf Labs. Because if you're a big-time cultivator, a small home grower, or even a patient just trying to grow their own medicine, you can find out 4 times faster the sex of your plant when you use the Plant DNA Sex Testing Kit from Delta Leaf Labs. They make it really easy to take a sample from your plant. Then you send that sample into the lab, and a couple of days after they get it, you'll know exactly what you've got to work with, whether that's a female or a male plant. So go over to deltaleaflabs.com and order your DNA sex testing kit today for your plant. And please don't forget to use coupon code IMGS10 so you can get 10% off of that order. Now let's talk a little bit about raw CBD, which is CBD that still has that delicate acid molecule still attached to it, a CBDA it's called. Now a lot of the times when hemp is processed for CBD oil, it's heated up. And that heat basically destroys that acid molecule. This is called a decarboxylation. We're just discovering how much more beneficial CBDA is than just regular decarboxylated CBD. It reacts something like 1,000 times faster on those CB receptors, and our bodies absorb it and use it more fully for that pain and inflammation that we like to use CBD for. And this raw CBD, that CBDA, is what you get in every product from 101 CBD. Doesn't matter if you're using it for anxiety and to help you sleep, or for pain and inflammation. CBDA is in all of it. So go over to 101cbd.org, order yourself some CBD oil, and at checkout, don't forget to use coupon code IMGS25 to get 25% off of that order. Now, just one more reminder about saving the date, and that is November 9th, because that's the day that the CBD Health and Wellness Expo is going to be happening at the Ventura County Fairgrounds in Ventura, California. They're going to have free health screenings that day, and a lot of different CBD vendors there that you can talk to and compare, which is a great thing when it comes to this very confusing market when it comes to everybody wanting to sell you their CBD product because they think it's the best. Well, let's find out. Go over there and talk to them. Compare them side by side. That's where they'll be. Once again, that's November 9th at the Ventura County Fairgrounds in Ventura, California. And keep an eye out for me and the In My Grow Show because we're going to be there too. All right, now let's start the show. Well, everybody, welcome back. This is the In My Grow Show, the podcast dedicated to taking the mystery out of cannabis. I'm your host, Alex. I want to thank you once again for showing up to listen to me. I appreciate you taking the time. And I'm real excited to get back on a Sunday schedule. Things have been really kind of erratic lately around here. I've been doing a couple of different things. I've been trying to get more episodes of the Spanish podcast recorded. I've been trying to get things together for the CBD Expo that's coming up. And then just regular family stuff that always comes up. You know, you got to take care of it. You got to hang out with your wife and the kids and, you know, got to go to work. So putting all that together is kind of throwing a wrench in my recording schedule. That's why I'm really happy to be here again on a Sunday. All right. And this episode is actually going to come out first on the website before it hits the podcast platforms. I hit a little snafu with the Libsyn's platform, but I think I'll get it taken care of in the next couple of days. Should be okay. But until then, this one's going to go up on the website first. So the other night, me and my wife were watching Hulu. And we started watching this documentary called Cannabis Evolution. And I got to tell you, it is one of the dumbest cannabis documentaries I've seen. It's almost like they had told one of the interns to make a cannabis documentary as fast as he could. And that's what they got. You know, some of the pictures and the narrations didn't go together. It was really weird. And then they got this like British or like Norwegian guy with an accent to narrate it to make it sound smarter than it really was. It was just really stupid. I couldn't watch it. I watched like 15 or 20 minutes of it and we changed it. It was too dumb for me to watch, which is saying a lot because I've watched a lot of stupid shit on TV before. I couldn't sit through this, though. It was insulting. Sometimes the guy would be narrating, and the picture that they would be showing, you know, the guy would be talking about cannabis, and the picture they'd be showing wasn't even a cannabis plant. It looked like some kind of nettle plant or something. I was all like, wait, that's not even marijuana. So, yeah, if you have Hulu and you see it, don't get excited. It's not that good. Skip it. Skip it. Go on to something else. Watch South Park. Even better. You'll laugh harder. Well, now let's move on to the strain of the week. And today I'm going to give it up once again to the Santa Cruz OG. The Santa Cruz OG is also known as the 831 OG. And it's a slightly indica dominant hybrid. It's like a 60-40. And it was made by the California Patients Association Farm. And I got to tell you, this stuff is a heavy hitter. It's a beautiful high. I really enjoyed it. Now, the Santa Cruz OG is a cross between the OG Kush and the Afgooey. And they did a great job at it, like I was saying. Because, it knocked me back. I felt really high for a long time. Nice and elevated, though. Nice and euphoric for a long time. Not just like plateaued stone, but like high. And it had this really great, like, flowery taste to it. It was like almost like a citrus butter. If that's even a thing, if you can even imagine that, it was just a really good taste. I loved it. I enjoyed it a lot. I enjoy my OGs anyways, but the Santa Cruz OG, if you see it out there, pick it up, get it. Once again, heavy hitter, so be aware. Don't smoke the whole joint unless you plan on being super high, which is fine. There's nothing wrong with being super high. I actually used to wrestle under that name, super high. No, that's not true. I might edit that out. That was kind of a ridiculous joke. Now, I just want to mention something real quick from my social media. Someone on IG turned me on to this thing called Calling Oats, which is a phone number that you call so you can hear some of Hall and Oates, the musicians, the band. You can hear some of their hits. It's the greatest fucking thing I've seen on social media in a long time. I called it. You know, the prompter comes up on the phone and it tells you for this song, press 1. For this song, press 2. I chose number 3, which was Man Eater. I love that song. That's why I couldn't tell you what the first two were, because I wasn't really paying attention. I don't even know what the other ones were, because I didn't go past number 3. All right, I'm going to give you the phone number so you can try it. It's 719-266-2837. Okay, that's 719-26-OATES, O-A-T-E-S. I really hope I got that number right, because if not, a bunch of you are going to be calling the wrong person. They're going to be pissed. Especially if you ask them to sing a Hall & Oates song. That'd be awesome. No, don't do that. Anyways, I thought it was the coolest thing. I got a great big kick out of it. I'll probably be calling it again to see what other songs are on there. But Hall & Oates, man. It's a hilarious thing. All right, now let's move on to the report from the Cannabis Front Line. And these are just some headlines that I've read in the past week or in the past couple of days. The first one's coming at us from Vice, and it's titled Why People Are Dying from Vaping in the U.S. and Not the U.K. This is by Alex Norcia. Came out October 10th. I'm going to start about halfway down where it says, Although experts canvassed by Vice acknowledge that the U.K. is in no way immune to nicotine-related health problems, the American vaping crisis that has produced at least 1,000 cases of illness and roughly 24 deaths is pretty much non-existent over there. There also appears to be a far less official concern that vaping is a gateway drug, sucking otherwise interested teens into a lifetime of nicotine use. Without lobbyists killing oversight and the 90s-style drug war hysteria hamstringing policy, UK officials have produced a piecemeal regulatory system that carefully monitors nicotine levels in vape products. The stark contrast has Americans' harm reduction advocates and their counterparts across the pond touting the UK's measured approach to vaping as more logical than a full-throttle panic in Washington and state capitals across the country. The only problem is American institutions seem ill-equipped to emulate it. I think the difference between the UK and the US are due to the Americans' propensity to turn health issues into moral crusades, said Brad Rodu, a professor of medicine at the University of Louisville and an expert in tobacco addiction harm reduction, who also noted that another big issue is the bureaucratic mess in obtaining funding for research in the States. It appears that policymakers in the U.S. are either completely ignorant of the history of tobacco or completely ignore it. American regulators have been roundly criticized for moving too slowly to get a handle on vaping products, only to embrace prohibitionary tactics, which could drive vapers back to cigarettes or additional users to the black market that may very well be what's causing many of the illnesses in the first place. So this article in Vice is a pretty long article, but it brings up a really good point about how these products are regulated in our two countries, in America and the UK. It seems like the UK had a better understanding of what these products were about and what they were going to do before they allowed them onto the market, whereas the US, the policymakers, they really didn't have an idea of what they were. They just you know, allowed it to go forward and said, yeah, let's, you know, let's see what happens, I guess. I don't know. But, you know, certain safeguards here in America weren't put in place. And this article is asking the question, how much of this health crisis is because of really bad public policy, really bad public health policy? It's super interesting to read, and it's a really good, you know, point that I never even thought about. I never even knew the differences. So there is a link in the show notes if you want to read the whole thing. As I was saying, it's a really just interesting point of view. The other article that I thought was super interesting comes from the Tampa Bay Times, and it was written by Catherine Varn. The title is Pinellas Sheriff's State Attorney Raise Bar for Pot Arrests. All right, it starts off. Pinellas Sheriffs Bob Gottlieb and Pinellas Pasco State Attorney Bernie McAbee on Wednesday issued a memo cautioning deputies about making pot arrests in light of a new law legalizing a type of cannabis called hemp. While the memo only applies to the county's 820 or so deputies, some Pinellas County police departments have also raised the standards for their officers to make marijuana arrests since the law went into effect July 1st. Wednesday's memos marks the first time the county's top prosecutor has issued an official stance on which marijuana cases his office is willing to pursue. There's just been some instances where cases were being made that were not prosecutable, McAbee said, and the sheriff was unhappy with that, and so was I. The memo spells out these standards. For creams and oils, the memo advises that deputies generally avoid making arrests unless the substance is in large amounts. Oils are typically consumed through vaporizer pens or e-cigarettes. In schools where vaping is on the rise, deputies were advised to avoid making arrests and instead refer the students to administration for discipline. For cannabis-infused products such as cookies or gummies known as edibles, deputies were told to make no arrests according to the memo. Check that out, make no arrests. Goes on. When it comes to plant material, deputies have a little more discretion under the new rules. Before the new law, marijuana had such unique properties that officers could rely on smell and appearance to decide there was probable cause to make an arrest. However, legal hemp and illegal marijuana flowers are indistinguishable by smell and appearance. Deputies must cite factors beyond scent and appearance to make an arrest based on plant material, according to the memo. Those factors include behavior, how the plant is packaged, and a subject's prior criminal history. Okay, I'm going to pause right there for that last bit. So since they can't use smell and the way the plant looks to distinguish if it's legal hemp or legal cannabis, a few of the things they can use is the behavior of the person they're interacting with, which is kind of bullshit because most people who interact with the police are going to be nervous and skittish because cops will cite that. Oh, well, you know, they seem nervous or skittish, you know, so that's why it was, I assume they were doing something illegal. No, man, a lot of law-abiding people get nervous when they're dealing with authorities. It's just a fact. The other one is how the flower was packaged. What does that mean? If it's packaged in a brick like you would see in a movie, that would be probable cause as opposed to just like in a trash bag. I mean, what exactly are the markers there for packaging? What's the litmus test there? And the last one I have even more trouble with. So let's say the officer is on the fence about the first two, but if you have a criminal record, if you're an ex-con, forget it. It's probable cause. Doesn't matter if the other two are wrong, if it's hemp, doesn't matter. You're an ex-con, your rights are fucked. That's crazy. I think they should do a better job about how to train these cops in recognizing it. You need to do a better job. All right, but let's move forward with this article. The St. Petersburg and Clearwater Police Departments have already rolled out similar rules for plant material. The cannabis enforcement changes arise from the legal quandary law enforcement faces over a bill passed by the Florida legislature this year that sets up infrastructure for the statewide hemp program and paves the way for legal CBD industry. CBD is a compound found in hemp and marijuana that doesn't get users high. THC is the stuff that does get users high, remains illegal, and thus prescribed by a doctor for medical use. Here's another kicker about this. Problem for law enforcement is in the measurement. Hemp-derived products will contain trace amounts of THC, so the new law allows up to 0.3% of the compound in products. But the field test used by law enforcement can only determine the presence of THC, not the concentration. I want to stop right there because I want to point something out about the Farm Bill. The Farm Bill basically took hemp and everything that's derived from hemp off of the Controlled Substance Act. I don't know if they realize what that means. So that basically means that any THC that is derived from the hemp plant is considered legal. Think of it this way. If you have 100 pounds of hemp and you process it and isolate just the THC and pull the THC out, you're going to wind up with, let's see if I'm doing my math right, either 30 grams of THC or 30 pounds. It might be 30 grams. Either way, you're going to wind up with a lot of THC isolate. Okay, now, concentrates and hash oil, they're a third-degree felony in Florida. You can get up to 5 years in jail for that. But the way I see it, and I'm not a lawyer, by no means am I a lawyer, but the way I see it from the way the farm bill is written, if I get busted in Florida with 30 grams of THC isolate, I can say that this THC that they caught me with is derived from hemp. Therefore, that THC is legal under the farm bill. You know what I mean? Like I said, I'm no lawyer, but this is the defense I would use. Now, if I'm going to use that defense, I also better have documentation that all of that THC came from hemp, because I'm sure it's going to come up. They're not just going to take my word for it. But it's an interesting wrinkle in what's happening in Florida. Because as I've said on past shows, I don't think people realize that that farm bill basically legalized isolated cannabinoids in any amount, as long as you can prove they came from the hemp plant. So it's going to be interesting to see if anybody uses the farm bill as a defense in Florida for carrying concentrates. Yeah, I guess we'll find out and see. Now, the last article I want to talk about comes from the Plymouth Express, and it's titled, Neighborhood Tells County No to Hemp, Cannabis Growers in Rural Residential Zone. And this was put together by Bennett Hall of the Corvallis Gazette Times. It starts, changes in the states and federal laws have paved the way for commercial-scale production of hemp and marijuana in Oregon. The issue remains a hot-button topic for many places as conflicts emerge between producers and their neighbors. Some of those conflicts were on display Wednesday night in Corvallis, where Benton County planners held a workshop on proposed code changes aimed at allowing those newly legalized industries to operate while limiting their impact on surrounding residents. Under existing rules, production of hemp and marijuana is allowed on land zoned for exclusive farm use or forest conservation, which covers about 80% of unincorporated Benton County. Those users are protected under state law and will not change. The changes under consideration would largely affect the rural and urban residential zones where hemp production is currently allowed. Medical marijuana is unregulated and production of recreational marijuana is prohibited. I want to pause right there. It says medical marijuana is unregulated. How can you have an unregulated system? I mean, unless it's black market, obviously. All right, I'm going to continue. Under the county's proposal, all of those uses would be banned in the urban residential zone, but could be permitted as a conditional use in rural residential areas. That prospect has a lot of rural residents hopping mad. Okay, so here's my opinion on all this. If I were those cannabis companies, I wouldn't put my operation, especially my cultivation operation, anywhere near a residential area. And I say this from experience because it sounds like these people in Benton County are going through the same thing that the people here close to me in Carpinteria, little town here, are going through. Yeah, if it were me, I wouldn't want them anywhere near residential because it's always going to be a fight, it seems. It's always going to be a fight. You know, there are a lot of people who do not like the smell of cannabis. And it's even a bigger fight when these growing operations are placed in already established neighborhoods. I mean, it's one thing if you already have a grow operation and urban sprawl kind of creeps in around you and you have houses built around you. It's another thing if you were going into an established neighborhood. Because those established neighborhoods, a lot of the people who move there, like I was saying, they probably don't like the smell of cannabis. So that's why I say it's always going to be a fight with the community. If it were me and I were consulting these companies, I would tell them to stay as far away from residential areas as possible. Because eventually what seems to happen is that the company winds up making these ridiculous concessions about what the community will allow them to do. And it just seems to hamper the production of cannabis. If it were my cannabis company, I wouldn't put it anywhere near a residential area. You know, because people get fiercely protective of where their homes are, where their families are. So, yeah, I don't know, man. I feel bad for the residents. I feel bad for the industry that's out there trying to make this happen for themselves. So, yeah, they'll come to some kind of agreement. Something will happen. And that, brothers and sisters, is a report from the Cannabis Frontline. And there are links in the show notes for all of these articles if you want to read them more thoroughly. Now, I want to talk a little bit about organic fertilizers. Now, some of you are probably scratching your heads. Why is he talking about organic fertilizers when it's Croptober and people are harvesting? Well, yes, some of us are harvesting. All of us outdoor growers are harvesting. All of the indoor growers, time's just moving on for them, man. You know, they're still in different phases. So yeah, I'm going to talk a little bit about organic fertilizers. If you go to inmygrow.com and just type in the search box organic fertilizers, my notes on organic fertilizers will come up. And that's basically what I'm going to be reading from today. I don't think I'm going to be reading all of the bullet points on there, just a couple of highlights. Now, organic fertilizers include soil inputs that are either made from animal byproducts. When I say animal byproducts, I mean like a bone meal, a blood meal, a feather meal. Also included in that organic fertilizers is obviously animal manure and vegetable matter, or, you know, compost, crop residues, or what they call green manure. Peat moss, guanos, and some slurries are also considered organic fertilizers. Inorganic fertilizers refer to any kind of synthetic fertilizer, anything that's been made with mineral salts or synthetic chemicals. I'm not going to talk about those today, though. Now, to be sustainable, one of the things organic farms need is to be self-sufficient in nitrogen. The best way for them to do this is the fixation of atmospheric dinitrogen. Or in other words, being able to capture that nitrogen and hold it in the soil so that it's plant available. Some of the ways farmers can do this is by planting legumes, recycling crop residues like green manures, as I spoke about earlier. Also by, you know, using, again, compost or animal manure. Because nitrogen typically is the most limiting factor in farming and growing in any kind of cultivation. So we have to be able to keep that nitrogen at a sustainable level for our plants really to thrive. A little note about dinitrogen, N2, it forms about 78% of the Earth's atmosphere, making it the most abundant uncombined element. Nitrogen fixation refers to the conversion of atmospheric nitrogen gas, N2, into a form usable for plants and other organisms. Now, one of the most common types of packaged soil amendments is manure or compost-based blends. The plant byproducts are mainly meals or cakes, like a cottonseed cake or a neem meal. And these meals or cakes are just the leftover plant material after they've been pressed to get the essential oil out of them. So whatever's left can be used as an organic fertilizer. Another thing that's used is fruit pumice, leaf compost, soybean meal, wood ash, potash, you know, things like that. As I was talking about earlier, the animal byproducts are going to include bone meal, blood meal, feather meal, fish meal, and even to some extent fish emulsion. But I'll go over that here in a little bit. And also don't forget, organic fertilizers are going to be a sustained source of nutrients since they have such a slow release because they're decomposing. As they're decomposing, they're releasing that nutrient into the soil so it can be broken down even further and made plant available. And all the prepackaged organic fertilizers are always going to have the NPK ratio, which tells you how much nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium that mix has inside. Now I want to talk a little bit about liquid fish fertilizer, because I do use it in my garden, but it's not my go-to fertilizer, my go-to nutrients. I know that I just can't feed my plants fish fertilizer and kelp fertilizer. I lean pretty heavily on my soil mix than I do on my liquid fish fertilizer. It's just there as a little filler. I just like to add it in. It also helps feed the microbes. It'll usually have some molasses in it. And there's a couple of reasons why I think fish fertilizer shouldn't be the only thing people use to feed their plants. One of the things is that liquid fish fertilizer is more expensive than other fertilizers that may have just about the same amount or more nitrogen in it for less money. The other thing is that liquid fertilizer doesn't really build soil. You know, it doesn't have any organic matter to help build the soil. Or at sometimes it doesn't even have the things that'll help build the aggregates, you know, to clump those bits of soil together. Now, I don't want you to confuse liquid fish fertilizer with dried powdered like fish bone meal. That to me has more nutritional value, the dry fish bone meal, than the liquid fish. Because aside from doing all of the things that the liquid fish does, the fish bone meal also helps build soil since it does have organic matter in it. Fertilizers that are mostly water-based like fish emulsion, hydrolysates, and manure teas may provide nutrition immediately, but they're not good sources for slow-release nutrients. They also don't build soil structure like I was saying. Fish emulsion start with the leftover bits from the fish industry, the parts that nobody else wants. These are treated with different types of chemicals and enzymes to start breaking them down. After it's been broken down for a while, one of two things is going to happen to that concoction. It's either going to be heated or cold pressed. Fish emulsion is the end product of the heating process. Hydrolysate is the result of using a cold press technique. In the process of turning those fish scraps into fertilizer, companies also added a couple of different chemicals. Most often it's phosphoric acid and other odor inhibitors. which is completely legal because according to the law, as long as those ingredients are less than 1% of the finished product, it can still be labeled as 100% organic. So it can be 99% organic, and then 1% of these other chemicals that they use to break it down. Something that we have to take into consideration when we're using fish is the kind of fish that's used to make these fertilizers. Most of the times, it's a fish called Manhattan, and anchovies are ground into a slurry. Now, quick note about the Manhattan. It's usually caught in harbors and rivers on the coast, so most of the time, they're exposed to some pollutants. Also, some lake fish are used sometimes, and they can contain high levels of mercury and PCBs. Also, sometimes sulfuric acid is added to lower the pH and prevent microbes from growing. And yet another thing we have to think about when we're talking about liquid fish food, the steam they use to remove the meat from the fish bones, or the fish frame, comes from municipal water sources, which contain chlorine. When the product is boiled down to a 50% solution, the chlorine is doubled and can be as high as 14% of the finished product. So some of that liquid fish food could have about 14% of chlorine. Now here's something we need to think about when it comes to that heat that they use to boil this solution down to 50% concentration. Okay, that heat is basically destroying all of the sensitive vitamins, amino acids, growth hormones, and enzymes that were in it before. So all of those things are just gone. No longer there once you start heating it up. It doesn't matter what the salesperson tells you, if it's heated up, it's just destroyed, man. It's not in there anymore. Now, some products have enzymes added back into it. This way the companies can call it a hydrolyzed process, but it's really just hydrolyzed emulsion. Okay, yeah, don't get confused with the salesman doublespeak. And the last thing to think about with liquid fish fertilizer is that it's only going to have about 2% nitrogen, which is about the same as other organic fertilizers, whether it's compost, manure, or coffee grounds. You know, coffee grounds were tested by the North Carolina State University, and it came back with a 2 for nitrogen and a 0.3 for the phosphorus and potassium. So is fish emulsion really worth it? I mean, if you're gonna be hand-watering a few plants, yeah, maybe give it to them. But if you've got a bunch of plants or you really don't want to spend that kind of money, there are other things you can use to get that same amount of nitrogen than you get in fish emulsion. Now to wrap it up, I'm going to talk a little bit about the different animal manures. One of the most important things you need to remember when you use animal manures is that you should never use fresh animal manure on your plants, on your crops. Okay, it needs to be aged or rot or has to compost, which turns it into a more flexible fertilizer in the process. Flexible meaning that you can use it on different applications. Fresh manure can have dangerous amounts of bacteria such as E. coli, which are destroyed when you're composting because when you compost it, it gets hot enough to where that bacteria dies. Another thing about fresh manure is that it's going to have a lot of ammonia in it. And that high level of ammonia could cause some really strange growth patterns on top of very possibly burning those plants because it is going to get really hot as it breaks down. Yet another thing we have to think about when using fresh manure is that it's also going to have different grass seeds in it, different weed seeds in it. And that can cause a whole different set of headaches if you're putting this fresh manure into prepared beds, vegetable beds, or a prepared field. That's another reason why we compost it, because that heat also kills those grass seeds. Alright, now cow manures are going to help with moisture retention. Horse manure is going to contribute to soil fertility. It's also going to improve water retention. As well as it's going to help you if you have really salty soil. It's going to help with that salinity. Now, chicken manure is probably the most popular manure only because so many people actually raise chickens in their backyards. Again, like other manures, it is going to improve soil fertility, and it also helps with root development. Here's the thing about chicken manure, though. It breaks down really fast, so it gets really hot, which means it makes the temperature of the soil really hot. You got to be really careful. You don't want to put on fresh chicken manure on your plant beds, like in the middle of summer, because as it's breaking down, it really could burn those roots and kill your plants. If you can, compost that chicken manure for about 4 weeks and let it break down a little bit. I have read about farmers using fresh chicken manure on their winter crops because since it does break down so fast and get hot, it does help keep the root zone a little warmer, but I've never tried it, so I don't know. Now, hay, straw, and weeds are good organic fertilizers, but they have almost no available nutrients for a quick feed. When you use these types of fertilizers, they're going to take a little while to break down. It's not like the fish emulsion that, you know, it has a quick release of nutrients. Nope, it's not like that. Hay and straw, weed, stuff like that, it's going to take a while for it to break down, but it will feed your plants for a longer period for sure. Now, as you can tell, I haven't even mentioned earthworm castings, and that's because I'm a big fan of earthworm castings, and I think earthworm castings deserves their own kind of specific show and specific topic to talk about, which will be coming in the future. I do just want to make one note about worm castings. And I don't remember where I read this. I read this in some old farming book. It might have been in an old 1960s popular science issue. I'm not real sure, but this is what I've read. If you mix 10 to 20% of earthworm castings, when you're composting manure from dairy cows or horse or chickens, those castings are going to eliminate that manure odor within 1 to 2 days, which is just one of the amazing things that earthworm castings can do. Well, brothers and sisters, I reached the bottom of my notes. Like I said earlier, I did not read every bullet point in this. If you want to read it all, once again, go over to InMyGrow.com and just type in the search menu organic fertilizers. And since those are the end of my notes, guess what? That is the end of the show. Now, if you have a question or a comment about this episode, please send me an email that is InMyGrow@gmail.com. You can find me also on Instagram, that is @InMyGrow, or look for me on Cannabuzz, that's just Alex Robles. And I want to thank all the artists who let me use their music to put the show together. I really appreciate that. And as always, if this episode has entertained you, enlightened you, or even given you a little escape from your day, do me a favor, go over to patreon.com/inmygrow and leave a financial donation for the show. That money just helps me buy equipment and pay for hosting fees. It just helps me keep the show going. Now, if you don't want to go to Patreon, you can go to inmygrow.com, click on the Support the Show tab, and you can buy a t-shirt, or just click on the t-shirt link in the bottom of these show notes. And yet another way you can help support the show is before you go shopping to Amazon, click on the Amazon link in the show notes, because that'll let them know that we sent you, and the show gets a commission. And as always, if you're a cannabis company that wants to advertise to our worldwide audience, again, just send me an email, inmygrow@gmail.com. Now, if you're a listener who can't support the show financially, don't worry about it, I get it. Here's how you can help. Subscribe to the podcast wherever you listen, subscribe to the website, inmygrow.com, and then subscribe to the YouTube channel, InMyGrow. After all that, just let 3 other people know about the show. That's it. Real easy. Well, brothers and sisters, I'm going to get on out of here. You know I love you all very much. And remember to always grow, learn, and teach.